Do we have observational evidence for the existence of a multiverse? One theory is that the phenomena we call dark matter is really the result of parallel universes that don't interact with each other in any way other than gravity. This would cause galaxies to appear to have much more mass than just their visible matter. And this corresponds exactly to what we presently observe. Another theory is that the equations of general relativity already indicate that a rotating black hole in one universe should create a white hole in another universe. Our entire universe may have been created by a black hole elsewhere in the multiverse. But presently, the most popular multiverse theory among scientists combines ideas from string theory and eternal inflation. This results in a continuous creation of new bubble universes, each with its own laws of physics. A number of physicists believe this to be the most likely scenario. Other scientists argue that we have no reason to believe in a multiverse at all. In this video, we'll explain the scientific arguments both for and against all the various perspectives. But first, let us briefly put this topic into historical perspective. This video is made in the year 2022. Approximately 100 years ago, in the year 1920, there was a great debate about whether the entire universe consisted only of our own galaxy. The first known observations of other galaxies were approximately 1,000 years earlier by the Persian astronomer Abd al-Rahman al-Sufi. He described them as a nebulous smear, or a small cloud, in his Book of Fixed Stars in the year 964. In the year 1755, the philosopher Immanuel Kant asserted that these types of nebulae are really separate galaxies, which he called island universes. Most scientists rejected this and continued to believe that our galaxy was the entire universe, and that these nebulae are therefore located inside our own galaxy. This question was finally resolved in 1924 by Edwin Hubble, who measured the distance to several spiral nebulae, thereby proving that they were, in fact, their own separate galaxies. Just a few years later, in 1929, Edwin Hubble shattered the prevailing belief in a static universe by discovering that galaxies are moving away from each other. In 1980, the American physicist Alan Guth and the Soviet astrophysicist Alexei Starobinsky each independently proposed the theory of cosmic inflation. Cosmic inflation is a modified version of the Big Bang theory, which says the following. During the first fraction of a second after the Big Bang, the universe went through an extremely rapid expansion called inflation. A scalar field present throughout space caused the rapid inflation. The rapid inflation ended when this scalar field decayed, and the energy of this field was transformed into subatomic particles, which then filled the universe. The universe then continued expanding, but nowhere near as fast as during the cosmic inflation. Cosmic inflation is presently the most commonly accepted version of the Big Bang theory, as a number of inflation model predictions have been confirmed by observations. However, if we accept cosmic inflation, then there is no reason to assume that inflation ever ended throughout all of space. This is because the scalar field responsible for inflation doesn't decay everywhere at the same time. Each time the scalar field decays in one location, it creates what appears to be a big bang in that location. This creates what can be called a bubble universe. Each bubble universe expands, but without the speed of inflation. By contrast, the space in between the bubble universes expands much faster because inflation is still occurring in the space between the bubble universes. New bubble universes continue to be created at a nearly exponentially increasing rate for all of eternity. This does not violate the conservation of energy, because the ever-increasing positive energy of the matter and radiation is balanced by the ever-increasing negative energy of the gravitational field. We call this theory eternal inflation. Though it is only eternal with regards to the future, and not with regards to the past, as this theory still indicates that there was a beginning to this inflation. Let's now consider what happens if we combine eternal inflation with string theory. String theory says the following. Fundamental particles are vibrating strings. Different modes of vibration result in what we think of as different fundamental particles. Though for string theory to work, we need many extra spatial dimensions for the strings to vibrate in. Spatial dimensions can be curved. Spatial dimensions can be curved into themselves completely, forming closed surfaces. The reason we think that there are only three spatial dimensions is because the other spatial dimensions are tightly curved into themselves, forming loops so small that we don't notice them. There are many different ways that the various spatial dimensions can be curved into themselves. Each of these different ways ends up yielding a universe with a different set of physical laws. One of these sets of physical laws would describe the universe we live in. Let us now return to eternal inflation. Different bubble universes would have their spatial dimensions curved into themselves in different ways. Hence, the laws of physics would be different in different bubble universes. Each different set of physical laws results in a different type of universe. The number of different types of universes allowed by string theory is extraordinary. This number far exceeds the total number of atoms in our visible universe. However, even this extremely large but finite number pales in comparison to the infinite number of bubble universes that would be generated during eternal inflation. With an infinite number of bubble universes, each type of universe would be generated an infinite number of times. Only a tiny fraction of bubble universes would have laws of physics which would allow life to exist. And hence, the theory goes, we are in one of the lucky bubble universes that are able to support life. Even if we reject string theory, and even if we reject eternal inflation, this last conclusion is the basic idea of many different theories involving a multiverse. That is, in a multiverse, the vast majority of universes would be completely barren of life. Only a small fraction of universes would have laws of physics compatible with the existence of life. One of the arguments in favor of the existence of a multiverse is that it would explain why the laws of physics appear to be fine-tuned to allow life to exist. This argument is as follows. The laws of physics, as we presently understand them, contain a number of constants in the equations. If these constants had taken even slightly different values, then it would not be possible for life to exist. Let us consider just a few examples. If the cosmological constant had been slightly larger, no stars or planets would form. If the strong nuclear force had been slightly stronger, almost all hydrogen would have been burned in the very early universe. If the strong nuclear force had been slightly weaker, few elements beyond hydrogen would have formed. If the difference between the masses of the up and down quarks was slightly altered, the stability of protons and neutrons would be affected. There are many other such examples. If there was only one universe, and the values of these constants were chosen randomly, then it is extraordinarily unlikely that life would exist. On the other hand, if there is a multiverse with different constants in different universes, then it's far more likely that there would be at least some universes allowing life to exist. Therefore, the argument is that given the fact that life exists, it is far more likely that a multiverse exists. There is, of course, another point of view. This is the view that the universe was created by God, and that God deliberately turned the constants in the laws of physics to ensure that life would exist. This fine-tuning argument is considered to be the strongest teleological argument for the existence of God based on modern science. Regardless of if one believes in God, there are many other possible positions regarding the issue of fine-tuning. For example, one position is to just deny that the universe is fine-tuned for life, because life need not be limited to life as we understand it. This position states that for life to exist, much wider ranges of values in the constants are possible, especially if we vary multiple constants simultaneously, rather than just one or two at a time. However, a number of scientists have investigated this and concluded that it's extremely unlikely that life of any kind would have been possible for any set of constants selected randomly. Though there is another way to argue that these constants are not fine-tuned for life to exist. This is to deny that the constants could have possibly taken any other values. For example, consider the following three constants in the classical theory of electromagnetism. Based on our understanding that light is an electromagnetic wave, we can predict the speed of light through the following equation. Therefore, these three constants can't just take any value independently of one another. Also, the speed of light is further explained in Einstein's theory of relativity. It does not make sense to measure distance in the x dimension in meters, while measuring distance in the y dimension in inches. Similarly, it doesn't make sense to measure distance in the x dimension in meters, while measuring distance along the time dimension in seconds. If we use the same units of measure in all the dimensions, then we find that the speed of light is exactly equal to one unit of space per one unit of time. Once we use the correct units for everything, then our constants are simplified to the following. Similarly, there may be very good reasons why all the constants in modern physics are what they are, and we just need to work hard to discover these reasons. Hence, the argument is that these constants are not fine-tuned because they couldn't possibly have taken any other values. Another position is the following. If we believe that the constants could have taken other values, the problem is that we don't know what the probability distribution is. Therefore, it is meaningless to say that having a particular outcome is unlikely. If the probability distribution is evenly spread out among all real numbers, then we would always conclude that there is a zero probability that the constants will take a value inside any finite range, regardless of how large that range is. But let us set these concerns aside for the moment. There is yet another possible argument. This is that there is only one universe, and that the fact that the universe supports life is just a matter of luck. This argument says that believing in a multiverse is a case of the inverse gambler's fallacy. The traditional gambler's fallacy is believing that a slot machine is more likely to win the jackpot if it hasn't hit the jackpot for a long period of time. This is a fallacy because each spin of a slot machine is an independent event, uncorrelated to past or future outcomes. Whereas the gambler's fallacy tries to project into the future, the inverse gambler's fallacy tries to project into the past. Suppose we walk by a slot machine for the first time and see that it won the jackpot on its most recent spin. It's a fallacy to infer from this fact that this slot machine must have previously had many unsuccessful spins. Each spin is an independent event, and a slot machine is just as likely to win on its very first spin after construction as on any other spin. Similarly, the fact that our universe got lucky in being able to support life is not a reason to believe that there must have previously been many unlucky universes. Our universe has the same probability of getting lucky, regardless of whether or not other universes exist. Each universe getting lucky is an independent event. However, there is a response to this argument. This response is the Anthropic Principle. If our universe had not been lucky, we would not be here to observe it. As an analogy, even if it's extremely unlikely that any planet chosen at random has conditions suitable to support life, it's not surprising that we find ourselves on one of these few lucky planets. This is like a casino in which we are only allowed to enter right after a jackpot has been won. In this case, upon entering, it is arguably reasonable to infer that there were many previous unsuccessful spins of the slot machine. Similarly, it is arguably reasonable to infer that there are many other universes. Let's now consider a completely different idea, and this time introduce quantum mechanics into the picture. Suppose there is only one universe. Suppose this entire universe is in a quantum superposition of many states, only a small percentage of which can support life. There is an interpretation of quantum physics which states that superpositions collapse only when observed by a conscious observer. If true, then it would not be surprising that the superposition could only collapse to a state with conscious observers in the universe, where life exists. This is different from another interpretation of quantum mechanics called many worlds, which is another type of multiverse theory. In many worlds, superpositions never collapse, and even conscious observers are therefore perpetually in a superposition of states. The argument for many worlds is that there is no reason to assume that superpositions collapse, and the theory with the fewest assumptions should be preferred. The argument against many worlds is that this theory can't predict probability distributions without adding extra assumptions to the theory. This brings us to a broader issue about all multiverse theories in general. The idea that we should prefer the theory with the fewest assumptions is called Occam's razor. If we take Occam's razor seriously, then doesn't this disfavor believing in any type of multiverse? Wouldn't it involve fewer assumptions for only one universe to exist? Well, it depends on how we count the number of assumptions. Arguably, one way to count the number of assumptions is by counting how many bits of information we need to provide to specify the theory. Consider the following two statements about a set of numbers. Statement 1. This set consists of all positive real numbers. Statement 2. This set consists of only one number, and this number is the following, specified to 100 decimal points. Making the second statement requires providing far more bits of information, and hence, it arguably contains a greater number of assumptions. In our present theory involving only one universe, we need to assume the specific values of many constants in the laws of physics to many decimal points. In a multiverse, we do not. But if we want to play this game, we can take it even a step further. This is to propose that every possible mathematical structure represents a universe just as real as our own. This represents an even far larger multiverse, with even fewer assumptions than anything we have discussed so far. Though perhaps this just indicates that we need to reconsider the role of Occam's razor in science. Much more information is available in the video Philosophy of Science. Please subscribe for notifications when new videos are ready. Special thanks to all the people supporting us on Patreon. Your support is very much appreciated.